Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel and welcome back to another review of Married at First Sight, season 11, episode 4, What Happened Last Night. So this begins with the morning after. Let's start with Karen and Miles. So they did not consummate their marriage and we all knew that. You know, I don't think any of them did, so let's not even play games with that. I don't think any of them consummated their marriage. Woody and Imani came over. Was it that night? Oh, yeah, the night before they came over to visit. Karen was exhausted. You could tell that she was really, really tired. That visit didn't last very long. So they just kind of stopped by and said hi, and then they left. So the next morning, they meet the in-laws. Okay, so Miles goes to have lunch with Karen's family. The mother was there. Her sister and her brother-in-law were there, and her little baby nephew was there. The father is present. Her parents are still married, but he doesn't want to film, which is understandable. So that's fine. He's not comfortable filming. I get it. I understand. He didn't sign up to be on Married at First Sight. You know, his daughter did. So if he doesn't want to be filmed, he doesn't want to be filmed. But, you know, of course, you know, we would like to see him and get his direct input. But I guess we're going to get his input from her mom. The mother was very straightforward with Miles about, you know, you need to take care of my daughter. You need to treat her right. So on and so forth. Of course, he promised that he would. What else is he going to say? And he'll do the best he can, I guess. And she gave her seal of approval. She likes Miles. She's okay with Miles. I guess the father's okay with him too. The sister, the brother-in-law are fine with him too. So they're welcoming him with open arms, and he's okay with, you know, her family. So that was Karen and Miles. Then Karen meets with his family. She was a lot better. Her personality to me came out a little bit more. You know, I guess she didn't have those nerves. She just was a lot more relaxed, a lot more easygoing. The conversation flowed at the table. She felt comfortable. She looked comfortable. She looked great. So I was happy. I was proud of my Karen in this particular episode when she met with his family. Everything went well. The mother asked her, did she believe in being submissive? She said she did. She said she believed in being submissive to her husband. She understood that the man is the head of the household, but she also said that, you know, the woman is the neck, so the woman controls the head. The mother agreed with that as well. Now, of course, the mother, you know, showed her overprotectiveness over her son. She's very, very protective of her boy, and she basically told Karen that if this doesn't work out, you know, if you end up breaking his heart or whatever, you know, mama will be right there to pick up the pieces. He'll be just fine because I'll be right there. So I don't know, you know, how Karen feels about that. You know, it's understandable. I think he's the only boy because I saw his sister there. He had two sisters there, his dad, the mother. I think he might be the only boy. So that might, you know, explain why, you know, she is as overprotective as she is. I don't really know if Miles is a mama's boy, though. I think the jury is still out on that. I think he is perceived to be a mama's boy because his mother is so overprotective. But I don't think so. I don't think he's a mama's boy. He doesn't really talk about his mom that much, or it doesn't appear that he has to always talk to her or confer with her. So, you know, I don't think he's that much of a mama's boy, which is good. But I was really happy to see how Karen was like finally coming out of her shell. Then we go to Amelia and Bennett. Bennett met with Amelia's mom and brother. And the big question there was, they had a good conversation. Everything was fine. But the big question there basically was, would Bennett be willing to travel if Amelia has to relocate for her job? And he really is not that, he's not that crazy about leaving New Orleans. He didn't say right away, oh yeah, that'll be fine, no problem. Basically, it's one of those, we'll cross that bridge when we get there kind of thing, but he's not completely closed off to having to leave New Orleans. So that's good. Then Amelia met with Bennett's mom and dad and sister, and that meeting went fine. The sister said that, and this was, you know, the main part of that whole scene was that the sister said Bennett does not believe in having biological children. He only wants to adopt. Amelia didn't want to go into too in-depth of a conversation at the table with his family about that, but they did talk about that later. So later on, when they met one-on-one, the subject of having kids came up, and Bennett was very headstrong about his belief in not having biological children. He's like, I don't believe in having biological children. He called it something. I don't know if he said it was selfish. Oh, unethical. He said it was very unethical to have biological children because the world is so overpopulated. And why create more humans when there are children that need homes already here? Great point. I 100% agreed with Bennett on that. I don't know if I believe in not having your own biological children, but I do understand his reasoning about overpopulation. There's already children here that need homes. You know, why are we turning our backs on them and leaving them in the foster care system when they need homes? And you have parents, or you have people who want to be parents, and you have children that need parents. Why not just match them up and hope for the best instead of creating more additional humans in an already overpopulated world? So he made a really good point. Now, Amelia wasn't like coming down on him hard, like, but I want to have my own kids and I don't want to adopt. You know, she made a good point. Now, the good thing about Amelia is when he was explaining his position on why he didn't believe in having biological children, she listened. She kept it calm and she listened. She didn't interrupt him with her own opinion. She didn't try to, you know, automatically persuade him that they weren't going to do it like that. She sat there and she listened and she heard him out. And then at the end of his speech, he said, but if when I'm married or if I'm married and my wife wants to have biological children, he says, I'm open to that because I would make her happy. And if she's happy, I'm happy. So he's open to that. And then Amelia came in and said that, you know, she sees nothing wrong with adoption. You know, she's willing to adopt. She'd be willing to consider adoption. She believes in adoption. She thinks it's a good thing. So, you know, they might compromise and have a biological child and maybe adopt two kids. Who knows? So I love that conversation, a very adult conversation. They heard each other out. And it was a very, very important topic because that is something that you need to talk about. You know, when you get married or when you first meet someone or, you know, you first are dating someone, is what is your stand on children? Very, very important conversation to have. Now, in this situation, they're having the conversation after they're married, but it's a conversation that definitely needed to be had. And I liked how they both handled that conversation. It was really good. So from there, we go to Olivia and Brett. So Olivia met with Brett's brothers. He had three brothers, and there's one brother that's kind of like the leader of the pack who did all the talking. So when she comes in, she sits down, they greet, whatever, they're having a conversation, and the brother said something to the effect of, oh, we did our research on you. Now, Brett's family and Brett himself, they have like a really dry sense of humor, I guess you could say. And sometimes it's hard for me to tell when they're joking and when they're serious, but I think he was serious. He said that they did their research on the internet and basically, you know, they saw nothing bad. They looked at her social media. They contacted her friends, I think, her coworkers, and they all had nice things to say. So I guess he was serious about that, which I thought was weird, you know, that they would go and find her friends and her coworkers and grill them on Amelia. I thought that was really strange, but I guess she didn't. She said, you know, well, I would like to know who you spoke to, but I guess she had no other problem other than that. They talked about children. The brother asked her, do you want to have kids? And I'm going to go out on a limb and say I don't think Olivia wants to have children, period. But that's an answer that's not received very well amongst a lot of people, because it's kind of like, why don't you like sweet, innocent, cute, cuddly, wuddly little babies? You know, what's wrong with you? Why don't you want to nurture a child? So people who don't want to have children I don't think they necessarily can just come out and say, I don't want kids, I don't like kids, I hate kids, and I've got better things to do than to change diapers. But instead she says, well, not right now. You know, there's other things that I want to do with my life. And then, you know, eventually at some point when I've accomplished all my goals, you know, maybe. But I get the feeling she doesn't want kids, period. She doesn't really want kids. I don't know. The brothers didn't say what Brett wanted. So I don't remember if Brett himself had mentioned already whether or not he was into having children. I don't know. But Olivia, to me, I don't think she wants kids. So Brett meets with her family. Now, this was kind of strange to me, was that her family is, I think they're practicing Christians, which is strange to me because Olivia doesn't want kids. And you would think that people who are practicing Christians or growing up in a Christian household, you know, having children would be an important thing that's taught and believed, you know, to procreate and to, you know, bring more people into the kingdom of the Lord or whatever. So I thought that was strange. Her family's Christian, but she doesn't want to have children. So they asked about his religious stand, and he said that he is agnostic. He respects his agnosticism, and he doesn't go to church. He doesn't practice. You know, of course, I guess he believes in a higher being, but he's not, you know, reading the Bible every night and going to church every Sunday. And I don't know exactly how her parents took that. I couldn't really read them on that. I think they were very stoic. They didn't really want to show their opinion. But I have a feeling that Olivia is probably not that much into practicing her religion either. So I don't know. And also, I feel like Brett is holding a lot of himself back. I just don't think we've seen the real Brett yet, because the Brett that I'm watching now really isn't the Brett that I saw in the very, very, very beginning before, you know, like in the preseason episodes. I don't think this is the same Brett. I feel like he's holding a lot back for some reason. And he keeps on feeding us the storyline that he's into Olivia. He's happy with Olivia. Olivia is the perfect woman for him. The experts did a wonderful job in matching him. But I'm still not sold on Brett and Olivia. Then we move on to Christina and Henry. So, let's start with Christina. Christina meets with Henry's family. And once again, the father steals the show. You know, he's the center of attention. Christina likes his family. And Christina likes his dad. I'm not that big of a fan on Henry's dad. I think he's a little bit obnoxious. I think he's a little bit tiresome, annoying maybe even, because his constant jokes about Henry are kind of wearing thin on me. I really am curious on the real relationship between Henry and his dad, because Henry is the butt of every single joke his dad tells. And I'm not understanding that. I don't get that. I don't like that, really. A couple of jokes here and there at the expense of Henry, fine. But like every single joke he says, Henry is the butt of that joke. He is constantly putting his son down, you know, in this funny way. And I don't like it. But anyways, Christina thinks he's hilarious. Christina had, you know, she likes his family. I guess they liked her. I don't know. I think the jury's still out on how they really feel about her. But she mentioned something about his friends, you know, Trishel and the gang. And she said that she liked them. I think she said that she liked them. And then they showed a clip of Trishel and the other girl. And the other girl had nothing really nice to say about. She didn't respect the process. She did not respect this whole married at first sight thing. Trishel's friend was like, she didn't respect. She said something. I don't remember what she said, but she said something, you know, really critical about this whole process and the people that want to get involved in this process. So Christina didn't really read them very well. Now, Christina, how do I feel about her? She's kind of sort of growing on me because she has patience with Henry. And, I don't know how much more patience she has, but she definitely has patience with him. She's really patient with Henry. Now, when she met with his family, she talked about travel. I think because she's a flight attendant, and she's been all over the world, and she's really big into traveling. And she asked, you know, does Henry travel? And, you know, they said that he really didn't travel. Traveling is really important to her, because that was also a conversation that she had with Henry one-on-one. I think it was the night of the wedding, and when they're in their hotel room, I think. And or was it when they were having breakfast? I don't remember. But they had a one-on-one conversation about traveling. And she talked about how she's been to all of these, you know, wonderful exotic places. And then she asked him, where has he been? And he said, I guess the furthest he's ever been was North Virginia or Washington, D.C. or something. So he's never left the states. And, like, this is not a big deal to her, but it's something that she brought up to his family, the whole traveling thing. And I'm like, girl, relax. I'm pretty sure if, you know, you as a flight attendant, you get, all kinds of perks and freebies and stuff. And I'm pretty sure if you want to go somewhere, he's going to go with you. He's not going to have a problem with traveling. So relax. He's going to travel with you. And when he met with her family, oh, it was crucial. It was so painful to watch. It was bad. Once again, Henry is mute. He's not talkative. He doesn't make a lot of eye contact. Her mother is trying to engage him in conversation. It was her mother, I think her aunt and her grandmother. And, you know, they're trying to engage in conversation, and he's giving very short responses. It's not as bad as one word responses, but they're very short answers. And he's busy looking at his plate, and, you know, while he's eating, and he's just not social at all. I mean, the social gene completely bypassed him. He does not know how to interact with other humans, which makes me wonder how he was ever friends with Trishel and that whole crazy bunch. Henry just doesn't talk. You know, you're trying to engage him in conversation, and he's like, he's so oblivious to it. He's just going to give you the bare minimum, and then he's going to shut up. And the mother was like, you know, do you know how to cook? And he says, no, he doesn't know how to cook. And it ended there. And then she says, well, we need to, you know, we can teach you how to grill, and we can do this, and we can do that together as a family. And he was like, yeah, I like that. Then he was quiet. And the aunt peeped it right away. She was like, there's something wrong with this kid. So she told him, you know, one of the things that's really important to Christina, and I was like, thank God she said this. She said, one of the things that's really important to Christina is communication. In other words, people exchanging words with each other on a continuous basis. So I don't know if Henry got that, you know, but the aunt peeped it right away. Like, okay, this guy is mute. He's not talkative. This is going to be a problem for Christina because Christina needs communication. The aunt said Christina's love language is communication. She likes to talk, which means you have to like to talk also as well. Yes, you need to be a good listener, Henry, but we need to know you're listening by how you're responding. That's how we know you're a good listener. So the aunt was like, yeah, she needs to have communication. It's really, really important to her. And the mom started talking, and I thought the mom was going to like piggyback on that, but the mom started talking about something else completely. And I'm like, no, mom, we need to come right back to the whole communication issue, and you need to figure out what you need to do to get this man to start talking to your daughter, or they're headed for disaster. Because when they, no, let's save Mexico for later. Moving on to Woody and Imani. Okay, so Woody meets with her family, and that was a good meeting. I'm trying to see, did anything stick out to me when he met with her family? Oh, he had mentioned that his last relationship, him and his girlfriend, cheated on each other. So that was a red flag, you know. Of course, they asked him, I think it was her stepmother, Imani's stepmother, asked him, well, are you going to cheat on her? Are you going to cheat on Imani? Like, what kind of a question is that? Of course he's going to say no. I don't like questions where the answer is not going to lead to anything, because the answer is going to be so obvious. It's not going to give you any kind of insight on anything. You know, what do you expect him to say? Well, I don't really know. We just have to see how it goes. Of course he's going to say, no, I'm not going to cheat on Imani. And then when she met with his family, the whole issue there was his anger, his temper. She asked, you know, so how is he when he gets mad? Now, the grandmother was trying to play it down because that's her grandbaby. But the mother was like, no, when he gets mad, he gets mad. He is channeling the devil. When he's upset, he is upset. And then the mother even went a step further and asked her, so what you going to do when you can't control him, when he gets that angry? And Imani was like, I'm just not going to deal with it. You know, you need to go sit in a corner somewhere, calm down. And when you've had your temper tantrum, then we can come back and have a conversation. So when they met one-on-one, her and Woody, when they met one-on-one afterwards, she asked him about that. And evidently, Woody has been to counseling with it. I mean, I guess it was that bad. He's been to counseling for it. And he says it's under control. He's okay now. You know, the counseling helped. I hope so. So, they all get to Mexico. The honeymoon's going to be in Mexico. They all arrive in Mexico. What stood out for me when they arrived in Mexico? So, Imani and Woody got a little bit closer. You know, Woody is really, they're warming up to each other really well. And it seems like as time goes on, Imani is like warming up more and more towards them. They're developing that intimacy that's probably going to eventually lead to them consummating the marriage. But, you know, he's slowly breaking down her walls. You know, she's letting him in a little bit, you know, so they're good. You know, they're good. They're communicating. She's letting him know what she's comfortable with, what she's not comfortable with. And he's accepting it. He's listening. And it's wonderful. And it's not like last season with Mike and Mika, when Mike told her on the plane on the way to the honeymoon that if they're not knocking boots, there's no marriage. So this was good. This was a breath of fresh air. Woody was like, okay, we're gonna take it at your pace, whenever you're ready, whatever. That was wonderful. Oh my God, let's talk about Karen and Miles. Karen got her hair braided and it was so, I am loving this new Karen. Her hair was beautiful. She got her hair braided for the vacation. Imani did as well. Her braids are pretty too. But Karen, she looked like a complete, she looks so cute with those braids. So when they get to Mexico, I mean, everything was wonderful. Everything was great. Everybody is getting along, but this is like they just barely landed. So how much trouble could there be? But it was nice. Everything was nice. I mean, Karen looks so, so, so cute. The only issue I had about Mexico was when Christine and Henry were sitting at their table in their hotel eating. And once again, Henry's mute. And Christine is trying to engage in conversation and he's looking at his plate and he's giving very short responses. And then it gets to the point where, you know, I guess she fell silent because she was like, where else can I go with this? You know, what else can I do with this? And it reminded me of, you know, the old couple at the restaurant, you know, that don't talk anymore. And it's kind of sad, you know, because you're watching this old couple that look like they've been married 100 years and they're eating and they're not talking. And if you are someone who's married and you're, a little bit younger, a little bit early in your own marriage, you're looking at them and you're like, oh my God, I hope that won't happen to me. Where we're sitting across the table from each other and we're not talking. And you wonder, what's it like at home? Do they not talk at home? And this is what I'm seeing in Christina and Henry. I mean, she was sitting there after she tried to engage in conversation because she was asking him about, you know, how was your trip? You know, how did you feel about the trip here? And he said it was tiring and long and whatever. And then she was like, well, you got your first stamp on your passport, which you think would have opened up the door to some conversation. But he was just like, yeah, I did. And that was it. And then she just kind of sat there and ate. And he definitely sat there and just ate. And I'm like, wow, this is your honeymoon. Okay, we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. So I think that's it. Yeah, that's it. First day in Mexico. Everything is fine except that Henry's still mute. And I'm still not buying Brett and Olivia. And I'm loving, absolutely loving Karen and Miles. And I think Karen, oh, I liked it when Karen said that she's not going to overthink it. She's just going to take it day by day. She's just going to enjoy Miles for being Miles. And just, you know, wait and see, because she is really worried about this not being as good as it seems. So she already sees this as a really good thing. And she's just hoping that, you know, this is not a facade. So she's just going to take it day by day, moment by moment, and just enjoy the moment. I'm like, yes, Karen, yes. So everything was good. If I missed anything, I'll bring it up later if I remember. Other than that, that's it, y'all. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye.